My mother-in-law and I had a rocky start. I understood her better as I got older, but at first I just thought she didn't like me and that I was never going to get over that hump. But she loved her children and her grandchildren. And she taught them to say something that I think, given how they all turned out, helped them to understand who they are. The grandkids would joke about it, but they repeated it often, even in fun. And they would just go around saying, I'm lovable and capable, I'm lovable and capable, I'm lovable and capable. And whenever we were together, they'd be in line, you know, getting their dinner, and they'd be on lovable and capable. I don't know if you saw the movie The Help, but that came out a few years ago. And in one scene, the maid named Abilene has her little protege on her lap, and she repeats to her over and over again, you is smart. You is kind, you is important. You know, with all the negative talk in our world and therefore the negative talk that creeps into our minds, how great would it be if we could hold on to those words, you know, I'm lovable, I'm capable, I'm smart, I'm kind, I'm important. As Christians, we sometimes feel guilty, you know, if we think those kinds of things because we think humility means that we maybe shouldn't. And we want to put others first, and we want to make sure that God knows we're not too full of ourselves. But here's the thing. First, that's not what humility means. And when we put ourselves down, or when we continue to tell ourselves that we aren't good enough, or smart enough, or able enough, or enough enough, we do a great disservice to God. After all, God made us to be enough. Right? God loves us to pieces. God has made a covenant of love and trust with us so that we can trust God and be God's hands and feet in the world. How much can we accomplish if we always think we aren't good enough, or we aren't wise enough, or we aren't able enough to do the things we're called to do, the things God counts on us to do? See, God doesn't wait for us to get perfect, right? So that we can serve. God takes us right now, right, who we are, messed up or not, and helps us do what we need to do. You know, there are many times in my life when I walked into situations I had no idea how to handle. When I went to my first appointment as a pastor, I knew nothing. I was still a seminary student, still walking around asking myself what I thought I was doing, still questioning God every day. You know, are you sure about this? You don't want me to do this? I'd been in my first appointment for about a week when I got a call from a family telling me that the grandmother was going in for surgery and would I pray for them. I said, of course, and did so, but I also decided to go and sit with them in the hospital while she was in surgery. They were a great family and it was a good chance for us to get to know each other. The grandmother, Dorothy, survived that surgery, but a few weeks ago, later had to have the same surgery again, and although she did survive that second surgery, she did not survive the ordeal. And so I got a call to come to the hospital. The family was gathering to say goodbye. When I got there, Dorothy had just left on her journey to glory, and everyone was standing in a daze in the hall outside her room, and they asked me to go in and pray with her. Probably one of the hardest things I've ever done in ministry was to walk into that room that day. I had never dealt with death. I had never seen anybody in that situation. I had no idea what to say to her family. I didn't know what to pray. A mantra comes to my mind when I'm in those kind of situations, and the mantra goes like this. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And my mind was screaming that mantra as I went into that room. And the family soon followed, and I stood there trying to look calm and pastorally when what I wanted to do was run. And then the 12-year-old grandson walked in the room. And when he saw his grandma, he sunk to the floor in a puddle of tears. I may not have known what to do with anyone else in the room, but I had just come off a 12-year gig as a youth director, four boys of my own, I knew what to do for him, and that's what started me breathing again. So I went and I rubbed his shoulders while he cried, and when he could stand, I stood with him, holding him up, letting him put the full weight of that morning on me. God had come to my rescue and has done it so many, many more times. No one is less equipped for this job than me. I am an introverted introvert. I don't like to speak in public. I don't think well on my feet. I'm better with a pen and pencil than conversation. I'm not self-confident. I'm not a lot of things. But here's my gift, and here's what gets me through. I love God. I adore Jesus. And I genuinely love him. I fall in love with you every time I see you. My empathetic heart literally hurts when you hurt and jumps for joy when you're happy. And I thank God for that gift, because even if I have no idea what to say or do for you, I know that my heart can reach out beyond my words, because God's love runs through me the same way that it runs through each of you. Throughout Scripture, we see God using imperfect people to do what God needs done. And I never quite understood why Jesus chose the people Jesus chose, but I'm guessing that his reasoning was to further prove the validity of who he was. He didn't call the popular or the rich or the successful, right? He called those who were poor and broken, but faithful. I can only imagine how confusing this must have been for the Pharisees and religious leaders, who were looking at this proclaimed Savior walking around with these bubble heads, right? You look at the stories in the Bible and we can see that it didn't matter where people came from. It didn't matter what they'd done, where they'd been. God calls all kinds of people. Listen to this list. Abraham was old. Elijah was suicidal. Joseph was abused. Job was bankrupt and argumentative. Moses had a speech problem and had murdered a Roman. Gideon was afraid. Samson was a womanizer. Rahab was a prostitute. The Samaritan woman was married and divorced over and over again. Noah drank too much. Jeremiah was too young. Jacob was a cheater. David was a cheater and a murderer. Jonah ran away from God when he called. Naomi was a widow. Peter denied Christ three times and sank in the ocean for lack of faith. Martha worried about everything. Zacchaeus was too small and money hungry. The disciples couldn't stay awake even an hour with Jesus in the garden. And Paul was a Pharisee who killed Christians before he became one. Romans 8:28 is a verse that I have relied on over and over in my life, and you can too. For we know that all things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to God's purpose. If we know that God can take all of our messes and weave some kind of tapestry of good into the world, then we understand that God can take whatever we have to offer and make it into something good, something that can be used to spread the good news to a hurting world. So if you ever feel like you aren't worthy enough, remember that God has always used flawed people to share hope to a flawed world. In God we find renewing and mending. God doesn't call the equipped. God equips the called. You've heard that many times, but it's a good thing to remember. God doesn't call the equipped. God equips the called. And no matter what you've been through in life, remember that this almighty, everlasting, unconditional love of God runs through your veins. You are lovable, you are capable, you is smart, you is kind, you is what important. Marianne Williamson said something that has driven me to try and be better, to try and get outside myself and all my little quirks so that I can serve God in a better way. This is what she said. I'm sure you've heard this. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There's nothing enlightened about shrinking so that people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children shine. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us, that's running through our veins. It's not just in some of us, it's in all of us. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. The takeaway this morning for our confirmations and for the rest of us is this. We are on a grand journey together. God created us and called us into this family of pilgrims. I read a great bumper sticker a few years ago that said, we are not human beings on a spiritual journey, we are spiritual beings on a human journey. In other words, this stop on earth is a step in our eternal story. And while we're here, we should not always be thinking about where we're going next, but how we can experience the fullness of being a human being here among other human beings. How do we make our time on earth a rich and holy experience for ourselves and each other? The best way I can think of is to remember who you are and live into that from the minute you get out of bed in the morning until you gratefully fall into bed each night. Remember that you are a child of God. You are lovable. You are capable. You is smart. You is kind.